Welcome. We're glad you're here. Today's worship service is going to be filled with the Spirit and open to all. Join me as we prepare ourselves in prayer. Gracious God, open our hearts that we may worship you with fullness and excitement, for we ask these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God, sing with me. How great is our God, and all will see. How great is our God.
Mother's Day and a great week afterwards, and looking forward to a fun weekend. It's supposed to be a beautiful weekend, And while I hate we cannot meet again at the church, I pray that this children's sermon finds you doing well, and we're just so excited to the day that we can come back to see each other face to face and sit in front of the sanctuary and do this children's sermon. When I was thinking about a children's sermon to do this week, I thought about prayer. When I was praying on it, I thought, why not just touch on prayer again? Because prayer is obviously so important. But even during these times, I find that prayer just brings comfort, and it brings joy, and it just brings all of the wonderful feelings of just being able to go to God with all of your frustrations, all of your praises, all of your joys, all of your fears, and everything that's going on during these uncertain times. So what my favorite thing to do is if you guys are watching right now, I would love for you to get your hands and get it in the prayer, the way we do prayer. And so keep your eyes open with me. But when you have it like this, when we pray, you know, the first thing we see is our thumb. And this is a reminder to always pray for those that are closest to you. So that would be your parents, your brother and sister, your grandparents, your family, everyone that is closest to you. Your thumb is a reminder to pray for those people. The next thing is your index finger. And we also refer to this as your pointer finger. And your pointer finger does just that. It points people, points things, points actions in a direction. It shows where you want to go. It tells people, like, you know, go away or come here. It's a pointer. And this is a reminder to pray for those who point us in the right direction. And again, that is our parents, but that's also our teachers. That's also our tutors. That's also Sunday school teachers. That's also church leaders. That's your pastor. All of the people that lead you in the right direction. So that is our pointer finger, and I want you guys to remember that because they point us in the right direction. The next is the tallest finger, right? Our middle finger. And that is a reminder to pray for those who are tallest in leadership. And that examples are people in our government, our president, even our city and county leaders, our county commissioners and things like that. It is a reminder to pray for those people because they have a lot going on as well, and they make big decisions for us. So we need to keep them in our prayers all the time. The next finger is our ring finger. Our ring finger is actually one of the weaker fingers. If you ever try to do anything with it, it is one of our actual weakest fingers. So this is a reminder for us to pray for those. When we think of weak, maybe we think of sick. We think of those people that need help. So this is a great reminder for our ring finger. We think of it as weak, and we just pray for those that really need the Lord during this time that are, you know, like I said, like are sick or hurting or just on our minds when we think of weak. The next finger is obviously our pinky finger, and our pinky finger is a reminder for us to pray for ourselves. We need prayer for ourselves. We have to be our best advocate, right? So I want you, when we pray for ourselves, it's not always I pray that I get the biggest and best Christmas present or my birthday party is bigger and better than everybody else's or things to that extent. It's to pray for us to be humble, to be kind. We think of fruit of the Spirit. We just pray that we remember that we are Christ's followers, that we are the hands and feet of Christ, and everything we do is to be pleasing to God. When I think about prayer and we think about ourselves, I love this verse. It says, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances. This is the will of the Lord. And when we think about giving thanks in all circumstances, sometimes it's really hard to go to God when we're hurting or when something really big just happened to us that is maybe devastating or really just kind of crushes us. And so prayer is just our gateway to God. And God tells us to go to Him and give thanks and everything. And so that's my challenge to you is during this uncertain time and when we continue to pray to God, just to find that silver lining in things and to give thanks to God for everything He has blessed us with, the Lord has blessed us with. Even sometimes when things go away or are not in our presence anymore, you know, one of the things we try to do or I try to do is just to give God thanks for the time that I had that, whatever it may have been. So my encouragement to you guys is as we go throughout still these uncertain times, that our prayer life just becomes, just skyrockets, just gets bigger and better and stronger. And sometimes prayer can be intimidating. I know a lot of you guys have talked to me about that. It's scary to pray. Sometimes we don't know what to say. We definitely don't want to pray out loud. And that's fine. And prayer is such an intimate and wonderful act that we can have with our Lord Jesus Christ. So this five finger thing, I pray that it helps you when you do go to pray and you just think, well, you know, what can I pray about? How do I even pray? What's the right way to pray? There's no right way to pray. Anytime we go to God, He loves it. Again, going back to that Bible verse, it says, this is the will of the Lord for us to go to Him in prayer. So I pray that this prayer sermon gives you guys a little encouragement and for you guys to go to Christ in all things, in all circumstances, and give thanks. And just for the five finger, for the prayer hand, for us to remember who to pray for, why to pray for them, and also to remember to pray for ourselves. So I miss you guys. I love you guys. And I cannot wait till we can see each other again in person. So I just pray that you remember the prayer hands, encourage you guys to pray. And if you guys would now, let's end in prayer. So bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we come to you today and just, we do give you thanks. We give you thanks for everything that you've blessed us with. Lord, the grace and love that you pour down on us daily, we give you thanks for. And even in these uncertain and uncharted times, when everyone's schedule is just kind of thrown up in the air and we're trying to figure it all out as it lands, Lord, I pray just for peace and calmness through everyone as we navigate this. And pray that we're able to come back to your house and just love on each other and rejoice being together in your house. But I pray that while we're not in your house, we remember that we can still do those same things, Lord. We can still communicate. We can still talk. We can still share your love. We can still go to you in prayer and continue to strengthen our relationship with you. Lord, we give you thanks for everything that you bless us with. And I just pray that you're with each and every one of these children as they go through these times. Lord, we give you thanks and we love you. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Thanks, guys. Have a great week.
Try to hear a new word from God, and I think it's very odd that while I attempt to help myself, my Bible sits upon the shelf with every promise I could ever need. And the Word was, and the Word is, and the Word will be. Tailored suit, does it fit across the shoulders? Will it fade when it gets older? We throw ideas that aren't in style in the Salvation Army pile and search for something more to meet our needs. The Word was, and the Word is, and the Word will be. Perplexed but don't despair. We are persecuted but not abandoned. We are no longer slaves, we are daughters and sons. And when we are weak, we are very strong. And neither death nor life, nor present nor future, nor death nor height can keep us from the love of Christ. And the Word is, and the
good. All the time, God is good. It's great to see you again this Sunday morning. I'm going to be sharing a message which I'm calling A Tempting Excuse. And it's based on a passage from James, the first chapter, verses 13 through 18. I invite you to listen now as we share those words, God's word, with us here today. Listen for the word of Almighty God. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Then, after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he has created. Brothers and sisters in Christ, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me now? Almighty and wondrous God, we do give you thanks that by the power of your Spirit, you bring us close together. You encourage us to open ourselves to you. And you remind us, Lord God, that by your Spirit, you may take the words that we have shared and join them together with a few that follow to speak that one word so that each may hear what it is we need to hear. Today, I pray, Lord God, you would give me the gift of preaching and those here gathered ears to hear it and hearts to make it real. We ask this in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Someone once said, I wouldn't be tempted if temptation wasn't so tempting. Oscar Wilde, who was known for giving in to temptation, once said, I can resist anything but temptation. It's not hard to understand why these things are said. Temptations and trials are around us all the time. It's easy to see how hard it is because all we need to do is look in our own lives to realize that very often we can be led astray by even the simplest of things. I remember a story about a young newlywed couple. The wife went off shopping one day. They'd only been married a very short time. And she went shopping and she came home with a very expensive dress. Her husband, when he saw this, was pleased on one part of himself for his wife that she would have something very nice. But when he saw the price tag, he was beside himself. And he asked her how in the world she could have bought this dress knowing how tight their budget was. Well, interesting thing was, the wife said, I know I shouldn't have bought it, but I couldn't help myself. She said, I was outside the store and I saw through the picture window the dress on the mannequin and it just kept calling to me. And so I went in the store and I asked them to try it on. And I wasn't intending to buy it, she said, but I looked at myself in the mirror and I kept looking and I thought to myself how good I looked in this dress. And I really needed to have this dress. Well, the husband said, yes, honey, but you know, you could have resisted this temptation. She said, I couldn't. It was as if the devil was speaking in my ear, telling me, you need this dress. You must have this dress. You should buy this dress. And her husband again responded, but honey, you're a good Christian girl. You know you need to tell the devil to get behind me. She said, I did do that. I told him, get behind me. And he kept whispering, from my vantage point back here, the dress still looks good. You should buy it. So I did. Well, it's a funny story about the nature of temptation, to be sure. But in seriousness, all temptations are very real. And they hit us at all kinds of times, even times when we don't expect it. Maybe that's why we have such a tendency to always try to shift the blame for why the things happen to us that do, when we give in to temptations of one type or another. That lead us astray, that bring us into the depths of sin, and from sin, ultimately heading towards and careening towards what James says is the ultimate goal, which is death. Temptations are very often easy for us to slough off and forget, especially when we minimize the significance of them. Very often they begin as small temptations. The story is rightly told of a small colony of mice and how easy it is to eradicate them. All you need to do is use a certain kind of rat poison. Now, what may surprise you is rat poison is basically about 99% made up of actual food. The other percentage, the 1%, is made up of a drug called Coumadin, which is a blood thinner. Very often, humans use it as a blood thinner for their own blood. But in the concentration that the mice or the rats would eat it in the food, in the poisons that are put out for them, in this 99% food, 1% poison, they eat it slowly. It's colorless, it's tasteless, it's odorless. And what happens is that the rats come and they find the food which they want and they eat it quickly. And as they eat it, they come back again and they eat it again and again and again. And at first, nothing seems to go wrong. Nothing seems to happen to them. Until slowly but surely, over time, their blood thins to the point in which they hemorrhage internally and ultimately die. Now, that's the way James is trying to explain the effect of temptation in our lives. When we face temptations, we often see them as relatively benign, a small thing that we might do that really won't have any ultimate consequence on us. It may be a one-time thing, we think to ourselves. It's only going to be this time and not another time. And yet, slowly but surely, these temptations begin to build up. Now, the problem is, a lot of temptations, especially those things that seem small at first, are actually temptations that we ultimately blame God for. These are the ones that I call the temptations that focus on things like doing things for God. It's, for example, gossiping, which is probably the one sin that's listed in Scripture more prominently than almost anything else. And it's the most common of all of the sins. And very often it's used by Christians and other religious people as a means to express our concern for somebody else. But in reality, it's just an excuse to be able to talk about somebody. Gossiping is a guise, of course, for caring for other people. But nevertheless, another kind of sin that's like that is judging other people. That is judging other people against God's standards, with the underlying implication that we are already meeting those standards and doing a fine job of it. So it's a way for us to look down on somebody else and feel good about ourselves. Now, the good news is that the temptations that we face in life don't have to overcome us if we're careful, and especially if we remember that we are empowered by God's strength to resist them. The problem is that we often want to excuse ourselves by blaming someone or something else. Now, this is an inevitable consequence of something we discover in the first book of the Bible in Genesis in chapter 3. When they're in the garden, Adam and Eve are told very explicitly that they could eat anything they wanted in there except for the fruit of two trees, the tree of good and evil, knowledge of good and evil, and the tree of life. Well, as it happens, Eve is out wandering about, and you remember the story. She encounters a serpent who is talking to her and tries to tell her that the things that God had told her were not true. She was being tempted, in other words, to disobey and to ignore God's truthfulness and his command in her life as to how she should live. So she takes the fruit and she eats it and immediately then takes it to Adam and shares it with him. And he eats it. Not too long after that, they find themselves naked in the garden, aware of their profane condition. And it is in that moment of time that God comes seeking after them. And as he calls out to them, and he encounters them, immediately they begin doing this blame game. Eve's trying to blame the serpent's trying to blame everything else. Everybody is blaming everybody else, and nobody's taking responsibility for the decisions they made to step off the path and to walk in a different path through the weeds, which ultimately can lead to death. Now, the power and the opportunity that we have as men and women of faith is that we have an advantage that a lot of the people throughout all of biblical history did not have, certainly until the time that the Holy Spirit was given to the early disciples and they went out in their ministry into the world. Before that point in time, people were trying to live up to the rules, to avoid temptations, to overcome their trials, and not fall into sin, simply and only on their own power. Now, some people have great discipline in their lives. They're very focused and they're very good at keeping themselves rigidly away from the things that can harm them and lead them in paths of destruction. Not everybody is that gifted and certainly not that disciplined. And so the advantage that we have as Christians today, as the early Christians discovered in their own lives, is that by the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit, which is given to everyone who trusts and believes in Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, they are given the power of God in the presence of their personage, in their very being, to be able to draw upon that strength through prayer and perseverance of faith, to be able to overcome the trials and the tribulations and especially the temptations that are thrown in front of them, if they're willing to let God help them do it. Now, the key to this all boils down to that one fundamental truth. The temptations that we face in this life are very real. The temptations that Jesus faced were very real. Three temptations in the wilderness the devil put before them. The fourth temptation he faced was in the garden, when he realized what it was that ultimately he was going to have to face: the torture, the terror, the pain, the suffering of the cross, for the sake of God's will, his Father's will for his life. And it was in that moment that he prayed that most incredibly profound prayer, when he asked his Father that he would take the cup that he knew he had to drink away from him, and then immediately substituted these lines: "Nevertheless, thy will be done, not my own." This was the desire of Jesus. So focused was he on the will of his Father for his life. Now, Jesus was certainly perfect, but he is a model for each one of us. The kinds of things that Jesus did in prayer and in his personal disciplined life enabled him to stay focused on his Father's will, even when difficult times came upon him, even when he was tempted to do things that would make his life easier. He nevertheless resisted those things because he was empowered by God's Spirit through him because of his prayerful focus on his Father. I would like to encourage us all to realize that we do face a lot of temptations and trials in this life, but that doesn't mean they have to defeat us. We are blessed, you and I, to have the presence of the Holy Spirit and each other to encourage and strengthen us in our faith and our walk. All we need do is trust God and depend upon Him and sidle up to each other and encourage one another, and we can overcome the temptations that come. And when we do that, we will find ourselves with no need to pass the buck to someone or something else. Thanks be to God for that wonderful truth. And let us pray. Most holy God, we thank you for the grace and the strength that comes to us through your Holy Spirit, allowing us to overcome temptation, no matter how strong or subtle it may be. In Christ's name we do pray. Amen.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man. You were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified and laid behind a stone, you lived to die, rejected and above all.